Las Vegas, an international resort mecca known for its gambling, luxury hotels, fine dining, and nightlife. It is the entertainment capital of the world and the crown jewel of the Silver State of Nevada. Just beyond the shimmering glow of the world-famous Las Vegas Strip is the most hostile and unforgiving territory in North America, the Mojave Desert. No other place in the Western Hemisphere is as hot, dry, or inhospitable. The ancient lake beds and vast expanses of rock and sand seem devoid of life. An apocalyptic region made of jagged stone, gravel pits, deep silt beds, piercing cactus, and temperatures in excess of 120 degrees. There lies within this seemingly untamable landscape a racecourse like no other, a punishing obstacle course that since 1968 has tested the strength and willpower of an elite group of racers. For nearly 50 years, the Mint 400 has held the title of the oldest and most challenging off-road race in America. And each year, 350 race teams in 25 classes of off-road vehicles gather to battle each other and Mother Nature for a chance to be recorded in the history books. The race attracts both professional race teams and weekend warriors, all of whom will wage war against each other and the legendary 400-mile race course. They will risk everything, yet less than half of them will make it to the finish line. It is the ultimate test of man and machine. It is the greatest off-road race in America. This is the Polaris RZR Mint 400, presented by BFGoodrich Tires. Thursday, March 10th, 10 a.m. In less than 48 hours, America's top off-road racers will compete at the 49th annual Mint 400. But right now, over 80 competitors have assembled at the Prim Valley Resort for the Method Race Wheels time trials.
Welcome everybody to the Polaris RZR Mint 400 presented by BFGoodrich Tires. This is labeled as the Great American Off-Road Race. And if you just look around at the talent, best off-road racers in the world are here to race this race.
The Mint 400 is one of the few off-road races in the world that holds time trials for the two fastest classes. Unlimited trick trucks and Class 1 cars. The unlimited trick trucks are elite, unrestricted, anything goes desert assassins. And the Class 1 cars, which look more like buggies than trucks, are every bit as powerful, but feature true independent suspension. Both classes are a threat at the Mint for the overall win, and their start order on race day will be determined by how well they qualify, not by luck of the draw. This allows the faster, more experienced racers to start up front. And since the winners of these two classes are often determined by mere seconds, this is a crucial aspect of the race. The 5-mile Mint 400 qualifying course is known for being very technical, and the margin for error is razor thin. Thousands of off-road race fans showed up to watch the drivers push their trucks through the challenging course. Method Race Wheels offered $5,000 cash to the fastest qualifier, adding to the pressure the racers felt. One by one, the racers took their turn tearing through the qualifying course, each hoping to find the right amount of speed without pushing it too far. Last Last year's fastest qualifier, Dale Dondell, lost control on the outside of a turn, sending his truck sideways into a K-rail. He and his co-driver were uninjured, but his truck was beyond repair. He would not race the Mint this year. As the best in the desert officials began to announce the times, it became clear that the Class 1 cars had come to race with the big boys. Ray Griffith pushed his Class 1 to the edge and ended up 10th fastest of the day, just behind Cody Parkhouse from Long Beach, California, also in a Class 1. Cody was a mere 0.6 seconds behind Las Vegas native Pat Dean, who pushed his Class 1 into 8th. 7th fastest was Las Vegas native and off-road legend Rob McCaffrey in his number 11 trick truck. Followed by Derek Sproul in 6th. Off-road champion Jason Voss in 5th. And Jesse Jones, who took 4th, surprising no one. The top three finishers were all Mint 400 champions from previous years. Bryce Menzies, another Las Vegas native and 2013 Mint champion, put down the 3rd fastest qualifying time. He was just 0.2 seconds behind two-time Mint 400 champion Andy McMillan. But it was the man himself, Justin Lofton, the 2015 Mint 400 champion, who beat the entire field and ended up on top in the pole position. And $5,000 richer, courtesy of Method Race Wheels. For nearly a half century, the Mint 400 has held the distinction of being the roughest and most grueling off-road race in North America. The race course is located just 20 miles south of Las Vegas and stretches across 120 miles of the most inhospitable desert on the planet. Unlike most desert races, which are point-to-point, the Mint is a lap race, which adds another layer of complexity to an already challenging contest. The official Mint 400 start-finish line is held at the beautiful Prim Valley Resorts, just behind Buffalo Bill's Hotel and Casino. Tens of thousands of spectators show up each year to watch the trucks rocket off the start line door to door. This year, the racers will leave the start every 60 seconds, make their way through the infield, and then blast their way out onto the race course due east into the Mojave Desert. At race mile 12, they will enter the Joshua Tree Highway, a beautiful but tricky area of the course that features lots of switchbacks. Pit A is located 29 miles in this year and is the first opportunity for the drivers to make repairs and get fuel and tires. Right after Pit A at race mile 35 is Rockets, which is a massive dry lake bed. 56 miles in is the BFGoodrich Tires shooting range. This unforgiving section of loose rock and deep G-outs can literally make or break the competitors. At race mile 65, it's the Quarry, which is an ultra-technical stadium-style section of the race course. Then it's on to the legendary Fox Proving Grounds. This is by far one of the roughest sections of the course and is absolutely brutal on the suspensions of the vehicles. Pit B sits at race mile 72 and is the only other pit opportunity prior to reaching the main pit at the start-finish line. Shortly after Pit B is Thumpers, another great spectator area where the racers skip across a series of dangerous rolling whoops. At race mile 83, there is a massive left-hand silt turn called Chokers. After Chokers is the second dry lake bed on the course called Warp Zone. From there, the drivers make their way back to the Prim Valley start-finish area and have an opportunity to stop at the main pit for fuel, tires, and to change drivers as needed. The Mint 400 race course is 125 miles long, and most of the competitors battle for three full laps nearing the 400-mile mark. Each of the 25 classes battle each other for first, second, and third in their group, and the top limited and unlimited racers wage war for the overall victory. ...5 a.m., race day. The tension is high as the limited racers began to gear up and make their way to the start line. The Mint race course is too rough and treacherous for every class to run at the same time. So the smaller, less powerful vehicles get their chance to compete in the morning race. The limited class race spans the ultra-fast Class 10 cars all the way down to the stock Volkswagen Bugs. Casey Folks, the Mint 400 director, prepared to send the teams off the start line two by two every 60 seconds. This year, 34 Class 10 cars showed up to compete, including last year's winner, number 1067 Roger Starkey, who took off next to 1071 Jason Coleman. Just behind the 10 cars sat Class 2400, a relatively new class based on a Ford production EcoBoost turbocharged motor. Number 2406 Nick Carolan looked fast right off the start line. Classes 1100, 5000, 6000, 3000, 2000, and 4400 all took off into the unforgiving Nevada desert. The blinding sun began to rise, adding yet another obstacle to the start of the race. The UTV class has become the largest class by far in desert racing, and this year, 65 came to battle. UTV World Champion Justin Lambert in the number 1918 Cognito Motorsports Polaris RZR led the pack off the start line next to 960 Ryan Laidlaw. They were followed by a familiar chase pack that included Mark Burnett, Brandon Sims, Mitch Guthrie Jr., Johnny Engel, and eight-time UTV Desert Champion Brandon Schuler. Rounding out the start of the limited class race were the vintage and stock VW classes. Many consider these racers to be the unsung heroes of the sport as they take on the vicious Mint race course with only the bare minimum off-road race technology. The Desert Dingo Class 11 team, owned by Jim Graham, brought a few extra cameras to document their race, courtesy of their friends at GoPro. It's lap one of the limited morning race at the world's roughest and most grueling off-road contest. And over 200 vehicles in 20 different classes have left the start line. Class 10 leaders Jason Coleman and Roger Starkey are out front. Coleman would like nothing better than to beat him. But as they shot across the dry lake bed, Starkey made the pass. Number 1153, Brad Wilson, began reeling in the Class 10 cars in front of him. He was off to a fantastic start. Jeffrey Cooley looked strong early on. He started 16th off the line and had already passed a few of his competitors. The rest of the field began to jockey for position, and as the ground began to dry out, the dust was starting to become a factor. Back in the UTV pack, race leader Ryan Laidlaw was driving a perfect race so far. Right behind Laidlaw, Brandon Sims made a pass on Justin Lambert and began running down Mark Burnett. Kristen Matlock in the 1954 Polaris RZR was battling with Michael Caffro. At pit A, Mark Burnett was forced to pull over with a mechanical issue. Ryan Laidlaw remained out front by several minutes, and Sims began to chase him down. Number 5068, Blade Hildebrand, looked fast and was passing clean. Roger Starkey came flying through the shooting range at race mile 57. With clean air in front of him, he was widening the gap and pushing far out front. Nick Carolan came through the shooting range minutes later. He had passed more than a dozen Class 10 cars so far. Lightning Larry Ragland came through race mile 35 in the 1999 Polaris UTV at a good pace, and the rest of the field began to settle into a steady rhythm. Up ahead, Brandon Sims passed Ryan Laidlaw, but it was short-lived. Ryan floored it and got back around Sims a few miles later, then dropped the pedal and blasted through the shooting range. Sims remained right outside his dust trail, waiting patiently for Laidlaw to make a mistake or get a flat. Dustin Jones, the 2015 Mint 400 UTV champ, passed Justin Lambert and moved into striking position for the lead. Casey Curry in the 4402 Ultra 4 looked strong at lap one. Rob White came through in the Jeep Speed class. He set a blistering pace on lap one. As the lead pack of racers passed the half point of lap one, it remained Starkey and Coleman out front in Class 10. Jeffrey Cooley continued to climb his way towards the front of the pack in his Alumacraft race car. For Jeff, doing well at the Mint 400 is a point of pride. He and his father both built his race car and many of the cars racing the Mint this year. Off-road racing is a family sport, and Jeffrey Cooley was born into the culture. His father, John Cooley, and his company, Alumacraft, are one of the premier chassis builders in the sport. At just 21 years of age, Jeffrey is a rising star in desert racing.
I've always been inside the shop ever since I was born. We've always been a family-oriented business, and coming home from school, straight to the shop, watching all the guys work and everything, and since then it's been evolved ever since.
Jeffrey has been part of racing since he was born, basically. He was born in like 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and I was off to the Baja 1000. For him to be involved with it right now, it doesn't surprise me.
I've been doing this forever, and just seeing all the guys work and how much fun they have doing what they love, and kind of just grown to love it over all these years, and it's hard to find something that you truly love to do as your job and as a hobby. Team is everything. Our team has been together for 20 years now.
Without family and friends, we could have never achieved what we achieved in racing.
After winning the Snorre Championship in Class 10, Jeffrey is moving up to the ultra-competitive 6100 truck class in a brand new Alumacraft-built vehicle.
We've always been known to build buggies throughout all the years. This is our new 6100 truck.
We've worked on design to come up with something that is an Alumacraft style, a style that's similar to the other cars that we have built. We use a lot of our thoughts and designs that we've used in other vehicles, such as Class 10s, and we applied that to the 6100 truck. We've been building, you know, race cars for a long time, and you know, we've gotten really good recognition, but we really haven't gotten recognition as a chassis builder because we don't do trucks. A lot of our Class 10 cars are looking to move up to the next class, and the 6200 class seems to be the answer for them. So we really do expect to build many trucks in the next year or two.
The Mint 400 is much more than an off-road race. It's an entire week of festivities. Thousands of off-road racers, manufacturers, and enthusiasts return to Las Vegas each year and take over Fremont Street downtown to show off their race cars, off-road products, and celebrate off-road culture. This annual gathering dates back to the 1970s, long before the giant hotels, casinos, and glitz of the Las Vegas Strip. The Mint 400 owners, the Martelli brothers, have carefully restored the legacy of this incredible event, and over the past 5 years have rebuilt the Mint into a giant spectacle of horsepower and speed. With the support of the city of Las Vegas, the off-road industry, and off-road racing fans, the Mint has once again become one of the largest and most important events in Las Vegas. This year, the off-road festival kicked off with the four-wheel parts vehicle parade. Over 100 race cars roared down the world-famous Las Vegas Strip as tens of thousands of Las Vegas locals and visitors watched and cheered. The 2016 Mint 400 Grand Marshal, off-road legend Rod Hall, led the group in his legendary 69 Ford Bronco. With over $10 million of off-road machinery on display, the crowds were wowed. On Thursday evening, the Mint 400 crowd took over Fremont Street. New to this year's Mint 400 was the Rigid Industries Truck Roundup, a special contest dedicated to truck owners ranging from mild to wild. There were five featured categories, including Vintage, Pre-Runner, Chase Truck, 1450 Class, and Street King. Best in Class awards were given out for each category, as well as a People's Choice Award and Best in Show. Over $20,000 in cash and prizes were taken home, all thanks to the generous support of Rigid Industries. Each year, the Mint 400 holds a national beauty pageant and reviews thousands of entries in search of a young woman to promote and market the race and off-road industry as a whole. This year, all of the Miss Mint entries were narrowed down to six finalists who were voted on by a panel of judges. After much deliberation, it was the beautiful Jade Worley of Newport Beach, California, who was crowned the 2016 Miss Mint 400. Former Miss Mint Amy Scott passed her crown to Jade in front of a massive live audience. Jade joined the ranks of Vanna White and Linda Carter, who were themselves Mint girls, and walked away with $5,000 in cash and a professional photo shoot with Mad Media. Shortly after the new Miss Mint was crowned, the top off-road pit crew teams in the sport took center stage for the Method Race Wheels Pit Crew Challenge. As in many other motorsports, a fast pit stop can determine victory or defeat at the Mint. The Pit Crew Challenge was divided into unlimited trick trucks and Class 1 cars, and each team battled head-to-head in a single elimination showdown that left the crowd of thousands cheering. In the end, Cops Racing narrowly beat AGM Motorsports in Class 1, and Menzies Motorsports took out Strobel Motorsports to win the trick truck class. On Friday, the Mint 400 took over 10 blocks of historic Fremont Street, making it the biggest contingency in the history of the sport.
This is bigger than the Baja 1000. You go win this thing, and it stands right up there on the top.
My favorite part about the Mint 400 is the atmosphere. I mean, when else do you get to bring an off-road crowd like this to downtown Las Vegas and the vibe and the energy, and it's by far the biggest race of the year.
All 350 race vehicles were slowly pushed through the massive off-road gathering and then carefully examined during a technical safety inspection. Meanwhile, over 35,000 off-road enthusiasts showed up to meet their favorite drivers, get autographs, and collect off-road memorabilia. No other motorsport lets fans get this close to the race vehicles and meet their heroes in person. As the rest of the limited field made their way deeper into lap one, the classes began to mix and merge into a symphony of off-road mayhem. Nick Carolan continued to fight his way through the Class 10 field, while the UTV chase pack made its way through the shooting range. Number 1018, Miguel Tornell, caught 1003 Justin Kleinman and passed him. Meanwhile, the vintage and stock VW cars mixed it up. Roger Starkey led the pack into the quarry at race mile 65. A few minutes later in the Pro Turbo UTV class, Brandon Sims began to chase 960 Ryan Laidlaw down as he approached the quarry. 1090 TJ Tulse was having a fantastic lap one. He remained in striking range of the Class 10 leaders, Carolan picked off another Class 10. At the rate he was going, he would soon be in contention for the overall lead. 1918, Justin Lambert of Cognito Motorsports came flying through the quarry next. He started in the very front of the Pro UTV pack and remained in the lead group so far. Moments later, at the exit of the quarry, Mitch Guthrie Jr. caught and passed 936 Jacob Carver. 913 Brandon Sims came into pit B and radioed ahead for a splash of gas.
This is 1913, you have a copy.
9, where are you going? What do you need, just fuel?
Yeah, fuel right now.
Man, S3's right behind us. Okay, try to make it as quick as possible, just 5 gallons and go.
Sims made it in and out of his pit in less than 30 seconds and remained in second place physically behind 960 Ryan Laidlaw. Roger Starkey tore through chokers at race mile 82 on his way to the finish of lap one. The Class 10 chase pack was right on his heels. As he flew through the Polaris RZR arch, Keith Wabel was right on his tail. Minutes later, after leaving the main pit for lap two, Starkey slid out near race mile 5 and punctured a tire. Wabel made the pass and took the lead physically in Class 10. Number 1071, Jason Coleman, came through minutes later. Jeffrey Cooley passed Starkey as well and moved into sixth place physically on the road. Starkey got going again, but not before giving up six positions. Not how he wanted to start lap two. The Pro UTV class made it through most of lap one and were approaching the start-finish line. 2015 Pro UTV champion Dustin Jones was sitting in third place when suddenly disaster struck. While blasting through the whoops at race mile 85, he lost control and went tumbling down in the race course. Justin Lambert passed Jones, and moments later, Ryan Laidlaw drove into the main pit in first place.
He was in the lead in about the first 5 miles, so that's his forte. He likes to get out front, run hard, and he came through A, and they said everything was awesome. Pushing hard, you know, he drives like a maniac. He'll if he keeps it together, he'll do good today.
Everything looks good? All right, get your gas and get you out of here.
Brandon Sims left the main pit in second place, just behind Laidlaw. He'd run a flawless race so far. TJ Tulse passed Hank Winter and began to build a gap on him right away. But moments later, he was forced to slow down while passing number 1031 Brent Peterson, who had put his car on its side. Jeffrey Cooley came through next and took an outside line around Peterson, keeping the pedal to the floor in Class 10. Brandon Sims continued to work his way forward as Ryan Laidlaw picked off some of the slower Class 10 cars and continued to push hard out front. Justin Lambert remained in third place behind Laidlaw and Sims, but he was in first place in the naturally aspirated Pro UTV class. Roger Starkey continued his push back towards the lead pack after sustaining a flat tire at the start of lap two. He was working his way up towards Jason Coleman. Nick Carolan came through 1 minute later and was putting on a clinic. If the Class 10s weren't careful, Nick would catch them for the overall win in the limited race. TJ Tulse and Jeffrey Cooley remained within a minute of each other in second and third place. 1167 Bob Elio was out on his second lap, with 1111 Doug Christensen right behind him. 2020 Ryan Etter in his EBR Motorsports race car looked strong. Rory Ward continued to push hard in the 4507 Challenger 4 race car, which was designed and built in 1977 by the late Mickey Thompson. 4501 Mario Alessi came through in his vintage Funco race car, a throwback to the days of yesteryear. Mel Wade III from Fullerton, California showed how the Jeep speeds get it done. Rich Voss was making it look easy in Class 8. There's an old saying in racing, to finish first, you must first finish. As lap two wore on, the course began to deteriorate, tempting the drivers to make a mistake. Drive too slow, and you risk getting passed or losing too much time to the field. Drive too fast, and you risk overdoing it and ending upside down, or worse. As the field of racers came through race mile 72, some were definitely in risk mode. But as anyone will tell you, you can't win the mint with one pass, but you sure can lose it. Back in the pro UTV battle, Brandon Sims was beginning to make up ground on Ryan Laidlaw. Justin Lambert remained in third and was cautiously making his way past lap traffic. Number 971 Wayne Matlock from Alpine, California was the sixth UTV overall on the road and third in the Pro Turbo UTV class. Meanwhile, his wife Kristen Matlock, 1954, was sitting in seventh place physically. Minutes later, she tore across the lake bed headed for the main pit.
Careful. Don't hit up again.
Meanwhile, back in class 10, Jeffrey Cooley came into the main pit.
10.2 race to main. We are in the main pit now.
He had made up a big chunk of time on lap two.
It's like we're either the first or second car on the road. Lumacraft also has five cars in the top six coming in, so it's a very exciting day for us. We do have one more lap to go, so we'll see how it unfolds in the last lap.
First. Here. Made some good time on that lap.
Yep.
Back in the UTV chase pack, Brandon Schuler came through hot at race mile 75. He was further back than he wanted to be at this point in the race, but as a former Mint champion, he knew anything could happen. Brandon and his father Bill Schuler were early pioneers of desert UTV racing.
We started out very, very early on in the racing. I think there's maybe one or two races that we didn't compete in initially.
When my kids were younger, my wife forbid racing in our household. As the kids started a passion for off-road vehicles and they started riding, you know, she realized that, wow, this is something that they really, really love, and she gave in, and one day she says, why aren't you guys racing these UTVs? And that was the hall pass we needed, and ever since then, there's been no looking back.
Their team, Jagged X Racing, have won an impressive 8 championships and paved the way for thousands of off-road enthusiasts to try their hand at competing.
As a UTV driver, you got tons of competition. We had a little bit of a jump on some people on learning how to, you know, build our cars and race our cars, and there are certain guys that have a target on their back. We happen to be one of those people. We've won a lot of championships in a bunch of different series. Won a bunch of big name races like the Mint, Vegas to Reno. It's something that you gotta pay attention to, and we don't wanna lose that title. No one wants to lose that title. You're never racing for 10th place. You always wanna be at the top.
Jagged X has won more races than any other UTV team in the sport. And they are always a threat on the dirt.
Our class nowadays is huge. It's one of the biggest classes at almost every race. If you have a RZR sitting in your garage, it's obtainable, and that makes our class really popular. It's definitely a growing sport, and I cannot wait to see what it brings in the future.
Hailing from Phoenix, Arizona, Brandon spends his downtime riding UTVs in the desert and dunes with his family and friends.
Not many people can say that they get to spend as much time with their family as their kids grow older. For us, we're together a lot. I see Brandon every day. I see Justin every day. You know, now I have 3 grandsons, and we're going to start them young, and they'll have plenty of dirt in their eyes by the time they grow up.
Brandon won the Mint 400 in 2014 in the Pro UTV class, but every year, the competition gets better and better. After starting 20th, he's now sitting in 8th in the Pro Turbo UTV class, while 960 Ryan Laidlaw continues to dominate out front. American off-road racing was forged in garages and backyards all over the country by car enthusiasts and grease monkeys who modified stock trucks and made them into stronger and more reliable race vehicles. No class represents this spirit of do-it-yourself racing better than the 7100 class. It may not look like it now, but this truck was once a stock 1998 Ford Ranger. It was purchased used 15 years ago and slowly built by Justin Park into the weapon of choice for the Bilstein 7147 racing team. The 7100 class was designed to be a budget-conscious class, built on production mini or mid-sized pickups and SUVs. They're modified to race, but unlike their big brothers, they must be built with a chassis and motor that are readily available to the general public and must retain the stock steering. The suspension of these vehicles is the same configuration as originally produced. They are strengthened and reinforced, but the original stock geometry must be left intact. And they are limited to 18 inches of suspension travel and a 35-inch tire. As part of the safety specifications for the class, a race fuel cell is installed, as are race seats, a racing harness, and of course, a roll cage. While the brake, hubs, and rear differential components can be upgraded, the hoods, trunk lids, doors, fenders, and bedsides are required to resemble the original stock vehicles. The vehicles must weigh 3,250 pounds minimum in order to compete. All of these class restrictions keep the class affordable to race and also push the drivers to focus on becoming better racers instead of relying on their trucks for a particular advantage. The 7100 class is one of nine classes that only race two of the treacherous Mint 400 laps. Justin Park and the Bilstein racing team are having a solid race this year. They battled their way from sixth up to third place and are headed for the finish line. As the rest of the two-lap racers headed into the finish, the pro UTVs were making their final pit stop at the main pit and preparing to head out on their final lap. Justin Lambert of Cognito Motorsports came in and out of his pit quickly. Meanwhile, up ahead in Class 10, TJ Tulse and Jeffrey Cooley remain neck and neck at the start of lap 3. Cooley fought his way past lap traffic and pushed hard to gain time on Tulse, maybe a little too hard. Cooley and his co-driver Martin Richardson detected a problem with their race car and are forced to pull over. Tulse passed Cooley and took the lead, but it didn't last long. He sustained a flat and was forced off the course to replace the tire. Roger Starkey, who led the entire first lap but relinquished the lead with a flat of his own on lap 2, once again took first place. Jason Coleman remained on Starkey's heels, with number 1072 Keith Weibel a few minutes behind him. Tulse was back on the road after fixing his flat, followed by Nick Carolan in the 2406 Ford EcoBoost car. It was an all-out sprint to the finish in Class 10. In the end, it was Roger Starkey, who once again proved he was a force to be reckoned with. But it was Nick Carolan in the number 2406 Ford EcoBoost car that really turned some heads.
Everything just all came together. It was perfect.
Yeah.
The perfect day for
it. The fastest I've ever been in this car, any car really.
He not only finished first in class, he took the overall limited race win by a margin of 4 minutes. The Pro UTV class began their final push to the finish. Ryan Laidlaw, who led most of lap 1 and 2, finally fell off the mark. And both Brandon Sims and Justin Lambert passed him. The massive field of 65 UTV racers had been cut in half as the Mint 400 racecourse became more and more chewed up. The husband and wife team of Wayne and Kristen Matlock charged hard on their final lap. Meanwhile, Laidlaw was back on course and tearing through the shooting range, hoping to make up lost time. Number 913 Brandon Sims remained out front and was driving at 110%. Sims had lost the Mint in the final stretch before and knew better than to start celebrating too early. Justin Lambert continued to make up ground on Sims. He had won the UTV World Championship less than a month ago, which was a tremendous boost to his confidence coming into the Mint. As Sims raced towards the finish line, disaster struck. But it was Lambert this time. Justin snapped a belt a mere 40 yards from the finish line. Sims and his co-driver, in a stunning display of sportsmanship, got out of their vehicle and ran back to help Lambert push across the finish.
I asked the Best of Desert official if I could help push it in, and they said, yeah, no problem. So we helped him push it across the finish line, and it helped him, he could finish second. So it was awesome, you know, just the way everything played out.
Sims would end up first in the Pro Turbo UTV class, and Lambert first in the Pro UTV class, naturally aspirated. Sims finished just ahead of Wayne Matlock and Ryan Laidlaw, who took third. Lambert finished ahead of Kristen Matlock and Ben Bischoff, resulting in a clean sweep by Polaris of both the Pro Turbo and Pro UTV classes. Other honorable mentions in the limited class race include the number 4507 Challenger 4 race car, which was designed and built in 1977 by the late Mickey Thompson. This remarkable vehicle had never finished the Mint or any other off-road race. But Rory Ward lifted the curse, giving Mickey his first Mint 400 win in the stock vintage class. Here's a look at all of the limited class race winners. As the rest of the battered field of limited class racers continued to roll into the finish, the unlimited classes began to prepare for their battle. Nearly 150 of the world's best off-road racers on the planet were about to take the desert by storm. The Mint 400 is one of the most iconic races in American automotive history. And it all started back in 1967 when Leroy Wickham and John Sexton spent a week driving two Coyote dune buggies from Fremont Street in Las Vegas to the Sahara Hotel in Lake Tahoe. When news coverage from around the world began to stream in about their incredible off-road adventure, it was enough to convince Mint 400 hotel executives Norm Johnson and his boss Bill Bennett to organize the first ever Del Webb Mint 400 Desert Rally. NASCAR legends Parnelli Jones and Mel Larson were recruited to promote and compete in the new race, and it was an overnight success. The following year, the purse and number of entries doubled. Parnelli Jones returned, as did racing icons Bob and Al Unser, Mickey Thompson, and actor Lee Majors. By 1970, the Mint had nearly 300 entries, making it the biggest racing event in history. It continued to draw attention from all corners of the globe. In 1971, the race was covered by Gonzo author Hunter S. Thompson for Rolling Stone magazine. He wrote his famous Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas article while covering the Mint, which portrayed the race as a symbol of the American dream. The article was adapted into a novel, later made into a feature film starring Johnny Depp and Benicio del Toro, solidifying the Mint's place in American pop culture. 1971 also marked the year K.J. Howe joined the publicity staff with the Mint. Howe would later create the Girls of the Mint 400, a beauty pageant that added an aura of sophistication and class to the race, and launched the careers of countless models and actresses, including Vanna White and Linda Carter. Over the next 20 years, the Mint became a worldwide phenomenon and continued to attract top off-road champions like Ivan Stewart, Jack Flannery, Walker Evans, Larry Ragland, Larry Rossler, and Rod Hall, to name a few. Fellow Indianapolis 500 winners Rick Mears and Roger Ward joined Parnelli Jones and Al Unser as an elite group of race car drivers who tackled the epic marathon. Movie and television stars Steve McQueen, James Garner, and Chuck Norris raced the Mint. But it was off-road legends like Vic Vanella, Drino Wilson, Malcolm Smith, Jack Johnson, Manny Iscara, Roger Mears, and Fritz Kreuer, who left their mark and made the Mint 400 a pillar of American racing. Tragically, in 1988, the Las Vegas Mint Hotel was sold and the race organizers disbanded. The world-famous Mint 400 disappeared. 20 years later, the mighty Mint 400 was resurrected. It was 2008, and that year Brian Collins and Chuck Hovey won the race overall, followed by the young prodigy Andy McMillan in 2009. Roger Norman took the overall win in 2010, and Las Vegas native ballistic BJ Baldwin won in 2011. Robbie Gordon claimed victory in 2012, beating out a stacked field of racers. And Bryce Menzies roared to victory in 2013. In 2014, Andy McMillan became one of a select few to ever win the Mint two times in his career. And Justin Lofton crossed the finish line first in 2015, taking home the Mint and solidifying his place in off-road history. The call went out over the radio. It was time to start the second race. Hundreds of unlimited vehicles sat in staging, nervously waiting for the green flag to drop. The crowd of thousands packed in along the start line, cameras in hand. The group of racers included the 8,000 class, 7,200, 6,100, class 1, and unlimited trick trucks. And at the very front sat Justin Lofton, the 2015 Mint 400 champion, and this year's fastest qualifier, a man who had proven already he could take the win. Casey Folks gave the 15-second warning, and it was go time. Lofton tore off the start line like a bat out of hell. He had earned the coveted pole position and had no one next to him. It was a pair of Mint 400 champions next, Bryce Menzies and Andy McMillan. Bryce took the whole shot and rocketed through the infield into second place. Jones and Voss left 60 seconds later, and Voss edged out Jesse for the fourth place position. Rob McCachran and Derek Sproul battled immediately as the green flag dropped. Rob has over 17 years of short course off-road racing experience, and it showed. He passed Sproul and charged hard. Pat Dean and Cody Parkhouse left next in their Class 1 cars. Parkhouse just edged past Dean, but there would be no rest with Pat on his bumper. Parkhouse looked strong coming through the infield. Ray Griffith and Josh Daniel took off, followed by one of the most exciting battles right after the start. 65-year-old Sam Berry in his single-seat Class 1 car against 25-year-old Lalo Laguna in his trick truck. Sam and Lalo barreled through turn one, and Sam came out ahead. But on one of the final infield turns, he caught an edge, and Lalo quickly caught up. Lalo chased Berry through the next two turns, eating his dust, and then threw it up on three wheels right before the road crossing. The rest of the unlimited trick trucks and Class 1 cars made it off the start line, two by two, every minute. Nearly 400 miles of mayhem lay between the start and victory. Who would make it to the finish line? There are dozens of slower, limited race cars still on the course, who are all now in a panic to finish before they are caught. Meanwhile, three former Mint 400 champions are at the front of the pack, headed into Joshua Tree Forest, near race mile 10. Justin Lofton, who started first off the line, was out front and running strong. He was the fastest qualifier this year, and with clean air, he had a massive advantage over the field. Bryce Menzies in the number 70 trick truck was mere seconds ahead of 31 Andy McMillan as they clawed their way up the mountain. Jason Voss was behind them, with Jesse Jones rounding out the top five. Bryce and Andy were running a blistering pace, hoping to catch Lofton right as he began to hit lap traffic. Minutes later, the leaders passed through pit A. Bryce remained unscathed.
Left rear tire, bud.
Left rear?
Yes, sir.
No way.
That's 21.4.
However, Andy McMillan had sustained a flat.
What's your pressure sensor say? Yeah, you gotta pull in and change it.
He wants us to change it.
While Andy waited patiently for his team to replace the tire,
get us out of here, guys.
Jason Voss passed him in the pit.
I got Jones in the mirror.
Seconds later,
Jones is on our right side.
Andy was able to pull back on the course before he was passed by Jesse Jones.
He's right there. He's gonna be right there. He's gonna be right there.
There you go.
Jesse wasn't too happy about the timing. Meanwhile, further back in the chase pack, after qualifying ninth and beating Pat Dean off the start, 15.01 Cody Parkhouse moved into eighth on the road. Back in 12th place was 2015 Mint 400 Class 1 champion Sam Berry. Sam was sitting right in front of Lalo Laguna, who had been right on his bumper since the start of the race. Suddenly, Sam sustained a flat tire and was forced to pull over. At 65 years of age and with no co-driver, Sam was at a disadvantage when it came to fixing flats. But he managed to do so in just under 8 minutes. Number 1529 Larry Job made his way towards the mountain pass. His GPS read over 100 miles per hour, a speed he would need to carry in order to pace the lead pack, which had now reached race mile 35, the dry lake bed dubbed Rockets. Lofton came through first like a speed demon. Next, it was 2013 Mint champion Bryce Menzies. Bryce was looking to shake off some bad luck at the Mint this year and take home the overall win. Jason Voss came through next. Jason is a best in the desert points champion, but the Mint 400 win had eluded him so far. 76 Jesse Jones flew by in fifth still. Jesse is considered a dark horse in the sport, one you can never count out, even for a second. 17 Lalo Laguna was now running down the chase pack as they began to encounter lap traffic up ahead near race mile 50. Justin Lofton began to encounter and pass the limited cars still racing, but it barely slowed him down. And behind him, Bryce Menzies, Jason Voss, and Andy McMillan were contending with the same challenge. The shooting range near race mile 57 was one of the roughest and nastiest sections of the course. And it was here that the elite drivers really began to shine. With no lap traffic to contend with, the lead pack tore through the range at breakneck speed, holding their positions as they made their way towards the quarry. Cody Parkhouse was the lone Class 1 car still in the mix up front, and he rifled through the torn-up alley. 2011 Mint 400 champion B.J. Baldwin came flying through next, followed by a massive group of talented racers, all waiting for anyone in the lead pack to make a mistake. Number 16 Cameron Steele and the Desert Assassin's trick truck flew down into the valley at top speed. He was 13th on the road. Up ahead, race leader Justin Lofton left the quarry several minutes ahead of Bryce Menzies. He tore past Spectator Area 1 on his way to the Fox Proving Grounds and Pit B. Meanwhile, back at the shooting range, 6196 Alex Gonzalez was leading his class. Christian Serapis came through 14 minutes after Alex and looked strong, followed by Troy Messer in the 7200 class. Al Hogan flew through next. Back up front, Justin Lofton left Pit B. He had not stopped for fuel or tires. Moments later, Bryce Menzies left Pit B, followed by the lead pack of unlimited trick trucks. The race leaders remained: Justin Lofton, Bryce Menzies, Jason Voss, Andy McMillan, Jesse Jones, and Rob McCachran.
Jones is the next truck in front of you, Rob, and he is 20 seconds ahead.
The unlimited trick trucks have made it to race mile 75 on lap one of their three-lap battle. 2015 Mint 400 champion and current race leader Justin Lofton is ripping across thumpers in front of thousands of off-road race fans. Moments later, another former Mint champion, Bryce Menzies, tore down the race course right after him. Further back in the pack, but at the front of Class 1, Cody Parkhouse came through like a man possessed. Number 1575 Pat Dean was right on his tail, waiting for the slightest mistake. 17 Lalo Laguna, who started 13th off the start line, has moved into 10th on the road and is looking strong. 12 minutes later, 16 Cameron Steele flew through Pit B and down towards Thumpers. 88 Brett Serapis chased through the same section of the course. Justin Lofton came through the Prim Valley infield and stopped in his pit for fuel and tires. Seconds after stopping, he was passed by number 70 Bryce Menzies, who made a tactical decision not to stop at the main pit and instead to take the physical lead. Jason Voss remained in third after pitting. Meanwhile, Andy McMillan, who came into the pit in fourth, took on tires and held his position.
Danger speed zone.
Okay, guys, good pit.
Still fourth on the road, race 31, still fourth on the road.
He's just keeping track position, keeping clean, not getting out of that truck, and stay with the pack, and it'll start thinning out later in the day.
Jesse Jones, who had held on to fifth place thus far, was passed by Rob McCachran at the start of lap two. Cody Parkhouse continued to impress, holding down first in class one and an impressive eighth overall at the start of his second lap. Further back in the field, the unlimited chase pack had made their way into the infield, and each took their turn flying off the infamous dike jump. 97 BJ Baldwin came into the pit. He had passed six trucks on course, moving from 22nd to 16th.
Okay, we pulled in for our pit stop, 16th place physically, 10th on time. Our pit guys killed it. Really smooth, nice pit. All the equipment looks great, so he's going out on lap two. Tried to reel in the leaders, make up about 3 minutes on corrected time.
Back near Chokers at race mile 82, Corey Kisar was sitting just outside the top 10 of his class. A former Mint 400 class champion, Corey knew that patience and timing were crucial for winning this race. Corey Kisar is a podium threat every time he climbs into an off-road race car. He grew up watching off-road legend Ivan Stewart compete on ABC's Wide World of Sports and raced motocross in his hometown of Colorado Springs for years.
We raced bikes for about 7 years. We just progressively kept doing more races. Finally, I had a kind of a bad crash in the Baja 1000 back in 06. Probably at that point, I just decided, you know, I probably need to get into a car, and because I didn't want to give it up. I loved doing it. I loved the experience. I loved the adventure.
After years of riding bikes, Corey began his four-wheel career in Class 10.
Made it a single seat, which I was like, why are you getting a single seat? I'm like, well, I'm usually on a bike and I'm by myself, so I'm gonna stay by myself, and did a lot of racing with that. Finally in 2010, got a brand new Jimco Class 1 car from Mike Juleson.
He won multiple races and points championships, and last year finished strong, winning his class at the 2015 Baja 1000. Corey's last Mint 400 race was back in 2014. He led his class almost the entire race, but it slipped away near the finish, and he took home second.
Yeah, I mean, this whole sport is about not quitting. You sit in a car for 14 hours, you're getting silt thrown in your face, rocks hitting your helmet, or your hands are sore because you're going through sharp edge whoops. It teaches you a lot of things about life in general. Most of the guys that are in off-road are pretty successful people, and that's why, because they're not quitters. And it's pretty tough when you're in the Baja Peninsula, 4 in the morning, and you've been up for 24 hours, and you gotta keep going. That's what it teaches you.
This year, Corey is on the hunt for a Class 1 victory, which is one of the most challenging in the sport. But he's got his work cut out for him. He qualified 59th and has 12 other Class 1 cars ahead of him that he'll need to outpace for the win.
Part of the challenge with the Mint is letting the car live, getting to the finish line, because if you're riding it at 120%, you're probably gonna make the first lap and pull over and something's broken. Every race is attacked differently. Winning those races is just a lot of experience within that track. The whole key with off-road, right, is to get to the car at the finish line at full speed on empty, so there's nothing left. That's probably when you're gonna be on the podium or you're gonna win the race. Winning the Mint 400 would be really the icing on the cake, because it's such a big race. It's a really meaningful race for guys that have been off-roading for a long time. I think the history even makes it more important to a guy like me.
It's lap 2 of the Great American Off-Road Race, and the brutal race course has begun to take its toll. Of the nearly 150 unlimited trucks and Class 1 cars that left the start line, more than a third have succumbed to mechanical issues. After leading the entire first lap, 2015 Mint 400 champion Justin Lofton relinquished the lead to Bryce Menzies in the main pit. Bryce is now out front, driving flat out, hoping to win his second Mint 400 championship. But Justin Lofton is right on his tail, followed by Andy McMillan and Rob McCachran. Jason Voss, who had held down third place for all of lap one, began experiencing mechanical issues and then sustained a flat tire. He was passed by Andy McMillan and Rob McCachran, but he was back on track and right on Rob's bumper. At race mile 51, Bryce, Lofton, Andy and Rob each came through at their peak performance, pushing their unlimited trick trucks to the absolute limit. 6120 Johnny Angle came screaming through in his newly prepped Geyser truck. Angle is a pro UTV champion and Baja 1000 winner. He was one of a handful of racers brave enough to compete in the limited race earlier in the day, then jump into a truck and compete in the unlimited race as well. Johnny was having a rough day and was still on his first lap, but the word quit isn't in his vocabulary. Number 65, Derek Sproul, came past minutes later with the pedal to the floor. Jesse Jones, Cody Parkhouse, and Lalo Laguna were right behind him, all jockeying for position. Seconds after Angle came through race mile 64, Derek Sproul and Jesse Jones came into the turn, door to door. Suddenly, the two made contact, and Sproul rolled violently onto his roof. Fortunately, neither Derek nor his co-driver were injured. And after course workers tipped his truck back over, he was able to resume racing. Up ahead at Pit B, a critical moment in the race began to unfold. Bryce Menzies pulled into the pit, desperate for fresh tires and gas. He had gambled and skipped pitting in the main pit an hour earlier in order to pass Lofton. Justin was over a minute behind Bryce. But as he entered the pit, Bryce was able to finish his stop and exit ahead of him, retaining his lead. Meanwhile, back in the Class 1 hunt, number 1542 Sam Baldy was having a fantastic race. He moved up 17 spots in his first lap and was picking off more of his competitors on his second. 1529 Larry Jobe, driving with Scott Bailey, was also running on point. He had passed nearly a dozen cars and was steadily moving into contention for a podium finish. Steve Oligus and his team were also having a great day. They had moved from 32nd off the start line into 6th place on corrected time at one point. He was running strong on lap 2 in the number 27 Geyser-built Ford Trick Truck. Las Vegas native Steve Oligus is a true journeyman of off-road racing. He's one of the original Rough Riders, and started competing just out of high school in 1981, during the golden era of off-road racing.
I was 11 when I first went there, and that's when I got hooked on it. I'm sure my family thought it was just a fad I was going through, but you just bought every magazine there was and read about it. You know, I was too little to go to, you know, Baja or whatever. Family wasn't going, but I followed it. And then it wasn't until I was probably 16 or 17 and I started going on pre-runs and kind of learning. And then when I was 18, I got a chance to ride in with the Collins brothers. It was a California 400 and it was just absolutely awesome. There's a Bronco shop that I was going to called KBRS, and they had a race truck down there owned by Hal Seelan. And I had the opportunity to drive Hal Seelan's Bronco, and that was my first race in 1984, the Mint 400 in a truck, and that was just the real deal.
At 11 years old, he watched the famous race from the sidelines and became fascinated with both the physical challenges of the sport and the camaraderie of the teams. It was the Mint 400 that inspired Steve to begin a lifelong journey as an off-road desert champion. And it was the first off-road race he ever competed in.
Back in my first Mint, I remember being on the parking garage where they kept all the race cars. And I actually got to ride in the parade out in the morning with Gordon Grimace, who wrote the book, The Racer. You know, to watch Mickey Thompson come down and Parnelli Jones and Walker Evans and the Scoop Vessels and to BFGoodrich Blazers. I mean, it just never gets old.
Steve has earned over 30 class wins and 7 championships in the sport and has a special relationship with the Mint 400.
It's that big of a deal. Logistics, you know, what we can do, testing the equipment, making sure we have the right powertrain, what we're going to run on that race for that course. The Mint, Alan Caromi says, it's the toughest race out there because that track just, it gets fierce. Like I said, over 50 guys that are all planning something, and it's going to come down in seconds again. Your pit stops better be better. The plans that you have, you better have it all worked out. The fact that we have BFGoodrich on our truck, I know that just gives me that much more of an advantage. I watched other drivers that are on BFG now that weren't on them, and they made the switch, and I know why they made the switch, but you gotta have the right equipment for a race like the Mint. People always ask me about, you know, my off-road race, and it's one of those things where it's like this addiction, and you can't stop.
Twice 2013 Mint 400 champion Bryce Menzies is currently leading lap two of the roughest off-road race in America. However, the contest is anything but over. Bryce was defeated last year and the year before. The Mint 400 racecourse is known for delivering crushing blows. Behind Bryce, by mere seconds, was last year's champion and this year's fastest qualifier, Justin Lofton. Justin has had a flawless race so far and had no plans to give up his chance for a back-to-back win. Andy McMillan sat behind Lofton in third place. He was running a clean race and patiently waiting for his moment to strike. In fourth place, living off-road legend Rob McCachran was picking his way through the course. Rob has won every major off-road race except for the Mint 400. Jason Voss sat in fifth, several minutes in front of Jesse Jones, who was still very much a threat to the overall win at this point. Number 65 Derek Sproul was up and running strong again after tangling with Jesse Jones and rolling his truck. Cameron Steele came through next, followed by Josh Daniel, BJ Baldwin, Abdelay Lopez, and Luke McMillan. Up at the front, the race leaders came crashing through Chokers at race mile 83. Chokers is a well-known silty turn, followed by several miles of dangerous whoops. Each of the trick trucks blasted through the turn and set their sights on the finish of lap two. Number 17, Lalo Laguna, took an inside-outside approach, avoiding some residual lap traffic. Race leader Bryce Menzies drove through the main pit first. He was followed closely by Justin Lofton, who took a quick splash of fuel before heading out on his final lap. And Jason Voss stopped for much-needed fuel and tires. Cody Parkhouse, who had run a fantastic race all day and put pressure on the unlimited trick trucks for the overall lead, came through the main pit and stopped to allow his father Brian to climb in and drive the last lap. Meanwhile, back in the mix, Justin Matney is battling some mechanical gremlins and fighting hard to make up lost time. Matney started the year with a bang, winning the Parker 425 in his four-wheel drive trick truck, a first for him and a head-turning performance for the new technology. The first four-wheel drive vehicle to win a major off-road race was a Bill Stropp-built Ford Bronco driven by Rod Hall at the 1969 Nora Mexican 1000. Rod won the race overall, beating the motorcycles by nearly 10 minutes. 50 years later, the four-wheel drive system has evolved into this: a Geyser Brothers-built four-wheel drive Rigid Industries unlimited trick truck. It's driven by the young off-road racer Justin Matney and has ushered in a new era of off-road evolution and ingenuity. Like its two-wheel drive brother, it is hand-built from the ground up using state-of-the-art computer-guided machines to make every part with military precision. It features the same monster engine package as most of its competitors, with a top speed of nearly 140 miles per hour. But it's the suspensions of these vehicles that are truly remarkable. They are able to soak up and drive over 3-foot ruts and holes without slowing down, and it's all because of their unique suspension design. Combining the massive shocks on these trucks with four-wheel drive may prove to be the future for the sport of off-road desert racing. Four-wheel drive has been a part of off-road racing since its earliest days. But over the past 20 years, as the top unlimited trucks evolved, they became two-wheel drive demons predominantly, with vast amounts of rear-wheel drive power. For the last four decades, manufacturers, and teams alike have tried to build a four-wheel drive powertrain that could take the insane abuse of desert off-road racing. It wasn't until early in 2016 when this newly developed four-wheel drive trick truck became the proof of concept, winning a desert race overall. It has a massive advantage in corner-to-corner acceleration and driving precision, and could change the game in off-road racing forever. It's the final lap of the roughest off-road race in America, and there is carnage everywhere. Of the nearly 150 unlimited race vehicles that left the start line, nearly half of them are broken and out of the race. For those that remain and are in the hunt for a podium finish, it's time to dig deep and pull out all the stops. Number 70, Bryce Menzies, remained out front, leading the pack of unlimited trick trucks. Justin Lofton remained on his bumper, just outside his dust trail. Behind Justin, off-road Hall of Famer Rob McCachran sat in third, dangerously close to the race leaders. Andy McMillan was fourth. Andy was the only racer in the pack to have won the Mint 400 overall twice in his career. And he was pushing hard, hoping to make yet another mark in the history books. In Class 1, Brian Parkhouse had taken over driving duties for his son Cody, who had pushed the 1501 Jimco race car up to the front of the pack all day. However, at race mile 16, Jason Voss caught Parkhouse and passed him, moving into fifth place. Voss caught and passed Rob McCachran near race mile 48. Rob had suffered a heartbreaking, catastrophic mechanical failure, and his race was over. Voss moved into fourth on the road. Up ahead at race mile 49, Bryce Menzies was still running strong, out front and leading. Justin Lofton remained right in his shadow, however, waiting for the slightest mistake or chance to advance. Mere seconds behind Justin, Andy McMillan in the number 31 Tisco trick truck was running at 100%. Andy dropped the pedal to the floor and smashed his way through the shooting range. His truck seemed to float over the massive G-outs and whoops. Suddenly, another heartbreaking turn of events unfolded. Bryce Menzies was forced to pull over with mechanical issues and would not return to the race. Incredibly, Justin Lofton was once again the race leader, out front, with clean air, and less than a half a lap to the finish line. Because Justin Lofton started 1 minute ahead of Andy McMillan, he would have to finish at least 1 minute ahead of him. The chase pack came through next. Though the overall win was out of reach, several in the group were battling for top 10 finishes on corrected time. Brett Serapis, BJ Baldwin, Lalo Laguna, and Cameron Steele. Meanwhile, back at race mile 35, Steve Strobel, Adam Householder, Troy Herbst, all came blazing across rockets on their final lap. Up at the front, Justin Lofton was barreling through the second half of the final lap. Andy McMillan remained on his bumper. With Jason Voss in third. As the sun disappeared and the Mint 400 race course became shrouded in darkness, tensions were high. Hall of Famer Rob McCachran and Mint 400 champion Bryce Menzies had fallen out of the running with mechanical issues. Justin Lofton, who started the race out front, stayed within striking distance after relinquishing the lead. He was now in first place, just ahead of two-time Mint 400 champion Andy McMillan, but only by mere seconds. He would have to finish a full minute ahead of Andy in order to win on corrected time. Meanwhile, a determined Jason Voss was running in third place, having battled his own mechanical gremlins. If Justin won, it would be an incredible story, a back-to-back victory on the roughest course in North America. If Andy won, he would become the only man in history to win the Mint 400 overall three times. As if the tension wasn't high enough, Justin was still encountering lap traffic as he sprinted towards the end of the race. Finally, Lofton and McMillan barreled through the finish line, one after another. There was a collective silence, and then a roar of applause. Justin and co-driver Derek Balkunas had narrowly won by a margin of 42 seconds.
Oh, it's unbelievable. I mean, I thought we were in trouble when we had on our pit strategy and Bryce got in front of us, and man, Bryce and Andy and Rob pushed so hard, and Jason, and it's unbelievable how fast the pace it was, but the course was amazing. We got that little bit of rain last night and made for one hell of a race, and I can tell you, he got close a couple times to Bryce on the backside, but it just wasn't quite enough, and his truck was running strong, and Andy was pushing hard from the back, and I sure wanted to get up and rub bumpers with him a little bit, but hey, I'll take it any way we can get it.
Justin took home $10,000 courtesy of Fox Shocks, two brand new Polaris RZR XP turbo vehicles from Polaris Industries, and the coveted Mint 400 overall championship trophy for the second year in a row. Andy would have to settle for second this year.
It was a close battle all day. You know, the first five or six guys were right there. It was fun coming into the speed sections on the pavement of the bridge over here, and you could see everyone just lined up and stacked up like equal distance in between every truck. So, you know, it was fun, just came up a little short.
Jason Voss came in a few minutes behind Andy in third place.
As we were sitting at the starting line, it was kind of interesting as you look around. You know, you got Bryce Menzies right in front of us, Justin Lofton, Andy McMillan, Rob McCracken's right in my mirror. I'm like, oh man, this is going to be a hell of a day. You know, it was good. As we came back around on the first lap, you know, I saw everyone was kind of stacked up. We moved around a few positions, and then it was halfway through the second lap when we first broke our header, and we thought we lost an engine. So we pulled over, and that was kind of our first problem, but we got back up and going, and yeah, I mean, it was a good day. We're not sitting on top of the box, but, you know, it was good.
Brian Parkhouse crossed the finish line seventh overall and first in Class 1. He and his son Cody had put on an incredible performance, at one point leading the race overall in their Jimco Class 1 car. Christian Serapis and Connor Jackson took 18th overall and first in class in their 6119 Pacifico truck. Here's a look at the class winners in the Unlimited race. As the remaining racers drove late into the night, the goal for them had changed from taking first to finishing. There's an old saying in off-road racing, respect is earned, 1 mile at a time. Of the nearly 350 race teams that left the start line, only 207 would finish, but none of them gave up. And for those who lost their battle to the Nevada desert, it would be there, waiting for them, ready for war again. The Mint 400 will return to Las Vegas in 2017,